Hello, my name is Katharina Nokun. I'm a Berlin-based writer and privacy activist. And 2 years ago, I published a book with the title The Data That I Summoned. And the title is a reference to a famous poem written by Johann Wolfgang von Goethe. And the book is about a little experiment, which was quite frightening for me, to be honest, because it was basically about how I learned more about myself than I ever wanted to know based on data requests. So what did I do? In the European Union, you have certain user rights guaranteed by the GDPR. The GDPR is the General Data Protection Regulation, which is enforced since 2 years. But even before the GDPR, you had in Germany the right to access your data of any company where you have a user account, even when you don't pay for an account or you don't pay for a service. You can anytime go to a company and say, hello, I'm a customer. I want to have a copy of my user data, and they are obliged to hand it over to you free of charge. So based under the GDPR, users have 8 basic rights, which are first of all, the right to information, second, the right to access, third, the right to rectification, for example, when they got your name wrong or your age wrong. And you have also the right to erasure. You can say, please delete specific data sets. And you have also the right to restriction of processing. For example, you can say you can process my data except of this specific type of data. And you have the right to data portability, which means that you can go to a service and say, I want a copy of my data, when you have like with the case of information request, but still additionally, you have the right to get the data in a machine readable format, for example, not as a PDF, but in a way that can be processed by machines. Why is this important? This is important when you, for example, decide to move from one service to another service and you want to take your user data with you. And you also have, based on the GDPR, the right to object, to specific use cases for your data, for example, when it comes to direct marketing, and you have the right to avoid automated decision making in specific cases, for example, when it comes to very sensitive healthcare data. So what did I do? Basically, I used 2 of these GDPR user rights. I used the right to access my data and the right to data portability. And first of all, I made a list of all the companies I found interesting for this experiment. And in some cases, I even decided to make a new account and to become customer of a specific service in order to leave a data trail, which I can later on access. So how does it look like? First of all, I went to my local grocery store, which was in Berlin, in Berlin-Charlottenburg, which is called Edeka, and I bought some products. And the interesting thing about my grocery store is that they have a bonus program, and this bonus program is part of a larger program where several supermarkets are member of, and I get a card, and every time I buy something there, I can use this card to get like bonus points. And so I went to this grocery store and bought some stuff. And later on, I wrote a letter to the company, which is called Deutschlandcard, and said, based on my user rights, I want to have a copy of all the data you have stored about me. First of all, they replied with a very polite letter saying, dear customer, we care a lot about your privacy. You can log into your online account and there you will find all of your data. I tried to do it, but unfortunately online, I only saw a small chunk of like the total data set. I only saw how much money I spent on a specific day and which shop I visited. But I thought maybe this is not everything they store. So I wrote a second letter and said, yeah, well, that's very interesting what I found online, but I don't think that's everything. Don't you have a list of every product I bought? Some weeks later, I got another letter, and there was this list. Here you can see like all the products I bought on this on one day, with the price, how much tax on every specific product is taken, the article code, like the specific code for every article, the product name and the category. So basically, this means every time I use my Deutschland card, the card for this bonus program, they collect every item I buy. Why is this problematic? Most people might say, yeah, well, it's only a grocery store or it's only a drugstore. What? Why should I care about privacy? And I often use a rather old example from the US to explain why people should actually care about this. Some years ago, a man who has a daughter, who is customer at a drugstore chain, which is called Target. Some years ago, a man called his local Target store and said, I want to speak to the manager. And he sounded very angry. So he was forwarded to the manager, and then he started telling him in a very angry tone, how can it be that my daughter gets personalized advertisement from your company, from Target, for baby products? My daughter is not even 18. She does not have sex. Do you want to encourage her to get a baby or to get pregnant or to have sex? And he was very angry. And the Target manager said, yeah, well, I'm very sorry. This must be a mistake. I'm very sorry. Please excuse that this caused inconveniences for your family. And this manager was actually very sorry. So he called this man back some days later. But then something interesting happened. The father took the telephone and said, yeah, well, hi, nice to speak to you again. But actually, I talked to my daughter, and it turns out that, some things happened at my household I was not aware of. My daughter is pregnant. She's getting a baby. I'm very sorry that I was mad at you. And this story is interesting because, I mean, I honestly ask myself, how can it be that the owner of a drugstore knows earlier that the daughter is pregnant before her own family knows about it? And there were some journalists from the US which had similar questions. So they started digging into this topic, and they asked the data science team of the Target's drugstore chain, how did you do that? And the data analysts told the journalists, yeah, well, basically it's very easy. We have a data set of millions of customers and millions of female customers. And we have a bonus program, and most of the people use credit cards and so on. So we can connect products to names. What did we do? We went through all this data and looked for traits. For example, women who at some point started buying baby products like diapers or food for babies. We wanted to know, did they change their user behavior in the 9 months before when they were pregnant? And they found around about 12 products, which are obviously, on first sight, which are not connected to babies or pregnancies, but which seem to be an indicator for telling that this woman is pregnant. For example, women who know that they are pregnant start or change their buying behavior when it comes to cosmetics. Many women started to buy unscented soap, unscented shampoo, and in general products with less chemicals because they were afraid to harm their babies. And they started to buy more vitamin pills because they were concerned that they don't get enough of certain vitamins and they cared about their babies. So the team at Target decided to connect the personalized advertisement with these data chunks. When you have like more than one or two of these indicators for pregnancy, they started sending out advertisement for baby products. And in most cases, well, in many cases, obviously, this worked out. And for the company, this was a very good strategic move because getting mothers as customers is very lucrative because mothers not only buy like food or the basic things they need, but they often buy things for the whole family and of course also for the baby. So they are very good customers. So they wanted to attract these customers. So what does the story tell about my data set? It basically tells me that even if I see all the products or every data I generated with this company, this means that the company might see more in this data set than I see, because the company can compare my data set to other data sets and can, for example, say, like people who buy these kinds of products, they tend to buy more alcohol in 6 months or more vitamin pills or more healthcare related products in several months. So maybe there's a like indication for a certain behavior. But still, even if privacy activists say, yeah, you should be a bit careful with bonus programs, I often have a choice when I use these bonus programs. For example, when I buy specific products like condoms, I still can decide this time I won't use my card, but I will pay in cash so it's not connected with my name. I don't have obviously this choice with many online stores, such as Amazon. In Germany or in Europe, Amazon is very, very popular and it's getting even more popular during the lockdown we now face because of the coronavirus. And 2 years ago, I was very curious what Amazon stores about its customers. So I decided to change my user behavior. What did I do? I actually have an Amazon account since 8 years, but I rarely used it. So I decided to change my user behavior and buy as much as possible on Amazon and look everything up on Amazon first before I buy it elsewhere. So I generated a huge data set, and after some months, I wrote a letter to Amazon requesting my data. Unfortunately, getting my data from Amazon was not as easy as I imagined, because it took several months of conversation via letter until they sent me a CD with my data. And when I accessed the data on the CD, I found a huge Excel list, and I did double click and opened it, and suddenly my computer stopped working. And first of all, I thought, okay, maybe my computer is too old again, or something is not right, or maybe it's malware. But after a minute, I noticed that no, it's not because of my computer and it's not malware, but it's because this list is just incredibly huge. This list had 15,365 columns. And for every column, there were up to 50 additional pieces of information. And this data set was called Clickstream. Just to give you an impression, if I would have printed it out, which I did not do because of environmental concerns, this would be so much that the paper would be higher than me. And I tried to dig through it by myself, but I very fast decided that it's not possible to do it alone. So I asked a data scientist, Katja Dietrich, to do a code-based analysis of this data set, which obviously included every click I did on Amazon during the last 14 months. She went through this data and based on it, she said, well, first of all, I can very easily tell on which days you were very active. And if you know when the birthday of my family members are, or when the birthdays of my friends are, you notice when you like compared with my interactions on Amazon that I'm rather a last minute present buyer. Also when it comes to Christmas. And you can also compare my interactions with my actual purchase, when I actually bought things. And based on that, I suddenly understood why Amazon is sending me advertisement, especially on weekends and on Fridays, because these are the days where I often buy things, or I mostly buy products. So these are very obvious things. And based on that, you could, for example, tell when I could not sleep late at night, because late at night at 2 o'clock in the night, I accessed Amazon and looked something up. Or when I was awake very early, or when I, for example, during the day checked something while I was working. But there were some things which were not so obvious, which are troubling from a privacy perspective. First of all, there was also a column with my location data. So what is Amazon doing? Based on the IP address, you can very roughly say where a person is right now. For example, is she right now in Berlin, or is she right now in Jakarta? So Amazon stored for all these clicks of the past 14 months where I've been when I did this click. And this was interesting because during the time of the experiment, I used to work in the northern part of Germany, but I lived in Berlin. So I traveled every week to Kiel, which is in Schleswig-Holstein in the north, and back to Berlin. And based on my Amazon data, I could not only tell on which days I was working outside of Berlin, but I could also sometimes tell when I missed the train in Hamburg, because there I had always to change the train. And because I was for a longer time in Hamburg. And based on this data, you could also guess how often I visited my family, because my family lives in the western part of Germany in Nordrhein-Westphalia, and you could this is obviously also the place where my Christmas presents are sent to, so you could guess like when are my family weekends. And of course, you could tell where I was on holidays. In these cases, it was the Bahamas, and it was Poland, which is like near Germany. And I originally also come from Poland. I was born in Poland. And Amazon also not only stored the location data and the telecommunications provider I used, but they also stored information about how much time it took for my browser to load the website. And based on that, you could even compare how good my internet connection was. And a comparison between the Bahamas, Germany, and Poland revealed what I was thinking since a long time, that the internet connection in Poland is basically far more better than in Berlin. And what was very interesting was also the so-called referrer data. And for people who work in tech, this is not a surprise, but for people who don't work in tech, this might be a surprise. The referrer data is basically, or is referring to the website I come from before I go to Amazon.com. So in my case, I often visited news websites like Spiegel Online. Spiegel is one of the biggest newspapers in Germany. And from that, I either clicked on a link or I went directly to Amazon.com, and Amazon noticed like from which website I was coming. And this was for me troubling because in many cases, the websites I came from had a political content. For example, you could see like what political articles I was reading. So this means that Amazon knows more about its customers than only the things which are connected to the website, but also knows about from which website we are coming to Amazon. After having a look at all these 15,365 clicks, I felt somehow naked. I asked myself, what does someone who doesn't know me might think of me based off my clickstream? And I had at some point the fear that what if this data gets into the wrong hands? What would this person maybe, or what would people think of me based on my clickstream? And just to give you one example why I found this troubling, just think about political affiliation. I'm a writer, I'm writing a lot about political stuff. So in my list of books I researched on Amazon, I found a lot of books which were very critical with the right-wing radical party AfD, the German right-wing radical party AfD, but you also found a lot of books which you could rather connect to very radical, very nationalist ideas, which I don't share. But as a journalist, well, as a writer, I research also books of people I write critically about, but only based on my clickstream. You could not tell if I'm rather left-wing or if I'm radical right-wing or if I'm even opposed to democracy as such. So I found this very troubling. I found this also very troubling because I was thinking about what if, for example, the police or secret service would decide, maybe Katharina Nukun is an interesting person. Let's have a look at her clickstream and see if she's made, if we find something which could be an indication that she's planning something dangerous. And first of all, what would someone see in my clickstream who's digging specifically for this use case? He would find that I'm interested in shooter games, like, for example, this game for PlayStation 4 with a nice title, Rush of Blood. And then I also researched a t-shirt with the slogan on it, chemist only because Superwoman is not an official job title. So you could maybe think, okay, maybe she's a chemist or knows something or a lot about chemistry. Why would she otherwise be interested in such clothes? And then I also was interested in a pressure cooker. And I don't know if you are familiar with chemistry or things like, or if you know how to build a homemade bomb, basically a pressure cooker can be useful for that. And I also looked up not only one, but several storm masks. I have very harmless explanations for all of these items. For example, this shooter game, I only researched it because I had a PlayStation 4 and I wanted to test the virtual reality functionality, and I just looked up any games. So I'm not specifically interested in ego shooters or games which are about killing people. rather the contrary is true. And the t-shirt was a birthday gift. A lot of my friends are chemists, but I actually, I'm not a chemist and I'm not so much interested in chemistry. And the pressure cooker is a pressure cooker and the mask is for skiing. And I don't know if you have ever been skiing with minus 15 Celsius around you. If you've ever experienced that, then you know that such a ski mask is very useful. So I have a very harmless explanation, but the problem is, when you have a clickstream of a person, there is no additional information like, I didn't mean this click this way or that way, or please don't get this click wrong. You only see the data, and the data can give you hints about a person, but also can give you a wrong impression. And my feeling is that we are living in times where companies try to explain a lot of things about our behavior based on our interactions, or they even try to forecast our behavior based on our interactions. And I think this is very dangerous when it comes to these specific use cases, because this can mean that people who have done nothing wrong can create into a very dangerous category and have like very, very severe consequences because of it. But I will never be informed if there will be such a category by secret services or by companies, because I can access my user data. But unfortunately, in most of my requests, I made the experience that they don't send you like what categories you are in, because they excuse that with that they are compiling this on the fly. That's why they don't need to give you this data. And actually, I think this is a major gap in the user, accessing your user data based on GDPR, that companies try to exclude this kind of data. And also, of course, we see not only since Edward Snowden, we know that secret services and police are using also company data in order to do profiling. So I think this is a really relevant issue for the future. After digging through my 15,365 clicks of 13 months on Amazon, I was very, very glad that I did this experiment only with Amazon.com. And I'm rather a conservative Amazon user, so to say. I almost only looked up books, and I also don't buy clothes on Amazon. But I have many friends who use a lot of Amazon services. And it's all connected with one user account. For example, a friend of mine reads every book or all his books on Amazon Kindle. Friends of mine even buy their grocery stuff or their drugstore stuff on Amazon. And many of my friends also use Amazon Prime Video to watch movies. And I was at some point glad that I didn't include this data to my experiment. But on the other hand, of course, I was curious, because most of my friends, they don't watch TV anymore. They use streaming services. So I wanted to know, what do streaming services collect about, or what kind of data do they collect about their users? So the next step of my experiment was I registered at Netflix.com and got a user account and spent 1 month watching movies, series, all kinds of stuff in the name of science. And after 1 month, I wrote a letter again, or an email to Netflix.com and said, yeah, well, Netflix, nice to meet you, based on Article 15 under the GDPR. I want to have a copy of my data. And they answered very quickly, actually. And first of all, they sent me my clickstream. how does a clickstream on Netflix.com look like? What you see here on the slide is like a very rough visualization of how 7 minutes on Netflix look like when I try to decide what kind of movie I want to watch. So first I browse a title, then I look up the details of a movie, then I look up in the category, look up a lot of details of several movies. Sometimes I click on playback to get a first impression of a movie, but then I decide I don't want to watch it. And after roundabout more than 20 clicks, finally I decide to watch something. And every click, of course, is monitored. And every search request, of course, also. And I found this very interesting, but also not kind of surprising after my Amazon request. But then I stumbled across an article where an employee of Netflix tells the journalist that he's very glad that they can access all kinds of user data in order to optimize the service. And he explicitly talked about the data of when people use fast forward or rewind or stop. And this data was actually missing in my data set. So I wrote again to Netflix and said, yeah, well, Netflix, thank you for the data, my data, but don't you think there's something missing? And I copied the link to the news article and they said, yeah, okay, actually, we found some data, and some weeks later, they sent me another data set. And this data set was really interesting. What you see on this slide is the so-called repository or pause activity of my profile, which is called Katharina. You can see there the device type, in which country I was, and the so-called reposition count, which means how often I pressed fast forward or rewind. And for every of these interactions, you have like the information from which second to which second I skipped. And you also have the information when I pressed pause and or stop, and in which second this was the case. Out of privacy reasons, I deleted the name of the movies I watched, just to tell you the movie with a reposition count of 19 was probably the worst movie I've ever seen. So why is this troubling from a privacy perspective? First of all, I was thinking about when do I use fast forward? Sometimes I don't like violent scenes when, for example, in a movie about war, people are killing each other. I don't want to see it sometimes, so I skip. Sometimes I watch the cheesy endings of a movie several times. Sometimes I only watch the cheesy ending, even. And this tells you something about me when I do that. When I skip violent scenes, then I'm in a specific mood. And when I look at the romantic ending several times, this tells you also something about my mood. And I guess there are also people who watch very specific, explicit parts of movies several times. For example, when it comes to the depiction of nudity or maybe sex. So this is, from my point of view, very private information. And the problem is that most users of Netflix probably don't know that. And some weeks after I got this new data set, Netflix launched a new kind of format for movies, which was called Black Mirror Bandersnatch. Black Mirror Bandersnatch was the first interactive Netflix movie. So what does it mean? It means that when you watch this movie, you have choices. You have you can decide like which choices the character in or the main character in this movie make. And based on your choices, you get a different ending. So from my point of view, this is a very interesting idea, because you can, so to say, play a movie several times and get a different ending. So in the beginning, you have like very easy choices. For example, your father asks you what kind of cornflakes you want to eat in the morning. But later on, you have like very, very severe decisions to make. At some point in this movie, the main character gets paranoid and he thinks that everyone is against him. And you are asked as a player, well, as someone who watches the movie, do you want to kill your dad? And if you press, I want to kill my dad, then later on you get the question, do you want to bury him in the garden, or do you maybe want to cut the corpse into pieces? And I don't know how you see this, but I think that these kind of choices in such movies tell you a lot about the personality of the person who's watching. And especially when you assume that maybe in some years you will not only have like one or two movies of this kind, but a lot of movies of this kind. So maybe sometimes you watch with friends and make different choices, but in general, when most of the choices are made by yourself, this tells you something about a person. So after I have watched this movie, I decided I want to know what Netflix thought about my decisions, and I wrote a request again and I got an answer. And yeah, it's not a big surprise, but every click, every choice I did in this movie was stored, of course. You have a full data set. So the problem I have with this is, often when you talk about privacy, and you often talk about Google and Facebook and these huge companies, and most people say, well, okay, you are concerned about privacy issues when it comes to Google or Facebook, but still, it's a free service. So if you don't pay for the service, you pay with your data, get used to it. But in the case of Netflix, I pay for this service. But just because you pay doesn't mean you are less monitored. That's my like most important lessons learned from that. And the problem is, of course, that based on this data, not only when you talk about Netflix, but also when you talk about Amazon, but also when you, of course, talk about Facebook, Google, and so on, you can tell a lot about a person. Yeah, you can say, for example, is this person likely to develop depressions in the next months based on big data correlation? Is this person concerned about love, health? What are their dreams? Does she have a sleeping disorder? Yeah, and all these information are, yeah, things we would talk about with our friends or family, people we trust. Yeah, but not maybe with a company which is based in a totally different company, and yeah, their main objective is not to help me maybe, but rather to make money based on this data. And this is very problematic from my point of view. I did a lot of similar requests with other companies for my book, for example, with Facebook, with Google, also with the German government. And I must tell you that I work since 10 years in the field of privacy, but I've never experienced the need for privacy this way, like I experienced it after this experiment, because it's one thing to know on an abstract way, okay, this company is storing every click you do, but it's something completely different when you see your own clicks and you think about, okay, who can access this data? Someone I never met, someone I don't trust can access this data and knows what I was interested in 12 months ago at 3 o'clock in the night. So I think everyone has something to hide, and it's not something bad, but something is just called privacy. And I think, well, I know for me that privacy is in a society which is getting more and more connected to digital services. Privacy is really the foundation to democracy, because societies that tell their citizens that they don't have the right to hide something are in most cases not democratic society. You need a basic space for yourself where you can just be left alone. And that is why I would urge everyone to inform yourself about what companies store about you. Also to inform yourself, what are the different legal frameworks of different countries to deal with this problem? Because I'm very glad that we have now introduced in the European Union the GDPR, because the GDPR gives every citizen in the European Union the right to access these kind of data sets I did access for my book. And I think only if you know what companies store about you, you can really make an informed choice. Do I want to use the service, or do I want to tell them they should delete specific types of data? So I think really this is something that citizens can benefit of, and I would really hope that also the introduction or the launching of the GDPR would start a debate worldwide about the future of privacy rights. Thank you very much.